What is up, you guys? So in this one, we're going to talk about Newton's method applied on nonlinear systems. If you've watched my previous lectures, you'd probably know that I have done a lecture on Newton's method, but on one-dimensional functions. This one, we're going to generalize stuff a bit, and we're going to see nonlinear systems, that is a bunch of nonlinear functions, and our goal is to solve them simultaneously. So what I have, it's not only one function and not only one variable. Instead, I will have n variables, x1 down till xn, and I will have n functions as well. And my goal is to find the variables x1 through xn that set all these functions simultaneously to zero. Now, in some references, you might find the equivalent notation or the vector notation, which is a more compact way of writing things. So f would be a vector as well as x, all set to the zero vector. So the zero vector over here would be this vector of all zeros, right? This guy would be all this. My x vector would be all this. And my f vector would be all this. This is another way of writing my nonlinear system. So the goal here is to solve this system using Newton. And if you recall in the one-dimensional case, because we're going to try to link things together, because you know the 1D is easy to keep in mind, right? It's as we saw, if we're solving f of x equal to 0, 1D, so f is 1D, x is 1D, then Newton runs as follows. Xn plus 1 is xn minus f of xn over f prime of xn, right? Well, the 1D case is really similar. Actually, it's almost the same. In our system, which we have written in a compact way as f bar x equal to 0, where f is a vector, x is a vector. Here is the nd case, right? In this case, Newton runs as follows. So we're going to check some similarities between this and the multidimensional case. So here, I've got a vector instead of a scalar, right? So as here, so xn plus 1 and xn are the same as before, but this time they're vectors instead of scalars. Minus, well, when we're talking about vectors, we don't have division as such. Instead, we have an inverse, then a multiplication. So I could have written the 1D case as f prime xn all inverse times fxn, right? Same thing. The inverse in 1D is the reciprocal, right? Well, it's this formula that is applied in n dimensions. So if I go down here, instead of an f prime, I don't have a derivative on a vectored quantity. The derivative over here is defined as a matrix, right? It's the matrix of derivatives. We're going to call it D of xn, and it's going to be inverse for the same reason we have here, multiplied with our vector valued function. This is Newton in n dimensions, okay? And how do we define our D matrix? Well, it's easy. It's, as I said, the matrix of derivatives. So it's defined as you take all possible derivatives of your function, okay? So actually, to be more accurate, you take all possible partial derivatives of your function. So the first entry of the vector valued function is f1. So you derive this with respect to all your variables. So you've got x1 evaluated at x, then you've got del f1 with respect to x2 evaluated at x, all the way down to del f1 by del xn evaluated at x. Same thing, you do this for the second function with respect to x2 all the way down to xn. You keep doing this till you reach your last function. That is del fn by del x1, del fn by del x2, and del fn by del xn. Now indeed, if you take a look at this, in the 1D case, you'd only have one function and one variable. Del f by del x, which is f prime right here, right? Okay, well, really, that's how Newton's method is applied on nd. We're going to see an example. We're going to work it manually. Then we're going to solve it on MATLAB. Now, let's say I've got the following example, just so that we know how to apply it on any type of nonlinear system. We've got the following 3x3 example. That is, I've got f1 of x1, x2, x3. That is 16 x1 to the power 4 plus 16 x2 to the power 4 plus x3 to the power 4 minus 16. I've got f2 of x1, x2, x3. That is x1 squared plus x2 squared plus x3 squared minus 3. And last but not least, I've got f3 of x1, x2, x3. That is x1 cubed minus x2. Good. So Newton over here is, as we said, xn plus 1 is xn minus d prime of xn multiplied by f of xn. Okay, f is this entire thing, so I don't need to write it down. All I need to get going is my d, right? So for the d, I need the matrix of derivatives, right? So I need del f1 by del x1 evaluated at x vector. Okay, it's x vector is x1, x2, x3. So it's the vector of all my unknown. So del f1 by del x1, I need del f1 by del x2, and I need del f1 by del x3, right? Likewise, del f2 by del x1 at x, del f2 by del x2 at x, and del f2 by del x3 at x, del f3 by del x1, and so on, by del x2 at x, and del f3 by del x3 at x, right? Now let's start by computing all my derivatives. We've got those 9 derivatives that we need to compute, so let's compute them. We start by del f1 by del x1 at x, that is del by del x1 of f1, which is 16 x1 4 plus 16 x2 4 plus x3 to the power 4 minus 16. We're deriving this with respect to x1, and this term is the only term that indeed depends on x1, so we derive it with respect to x1, and everything else is 0. We're left with 64 x1 to the power 3, right? Because 4 times 16 is 64. Likewise, del f1 by del x2 at x is the same quantity, but this time derived with respect to x2, which gives me the same thing, but this time x2 cubed. The third derivative, del f1 with respect to del x3, we're deriving the same term, right? Will give me, I have only this term that depends on x3, so I get 4x3 cubed, right? Okay, we finished the first three derivatives. Let's go to the second three derivatives, which are del f2 by del x1 at x, where I have x1 squared plus x2 squared plus x3 squared minus 3. We derive with respect to x1, we get 2x1. Now I'm not going to write the same thing down because this guy is symmetric. x2, we get 2x2, and x3 squared, we get 2x3. I'm just going to write the derivative. Here we've got 2x2, and here I've got 2x3. Okay, now let's do the partial derivatives for f3. We start by f3, replacing it, we have x1 cubed minus x2. The derivative with respect to x1 is 3x1 squared. Okay, we're almost done. Bear with me. So the derivative with respect to x2 of this guy is minus 1, and with respect to x3 is 0, because we don't have terms that contain x3. Now that we have our 9 partial derivatives, I know what dx is. So this means that Newton is going to run as such. Here I'm zooming in on each and every quantity. So x1, x2, x3 at iteration k plus 1, right, is going to be x1, x2, x3 at iteration k minus this matrix right here, which is 64 x1 at iteration k cube, 64 x2 at iteration k cube, and 4 x3 at iteration k cube, right? Likewise, I've got 2x1 at iteration k, 2x2 at iteration k, and 2x3 at iteration k. We've got a 0, minus 1, and 3x1 at iteration k square, multiplied by f1, x at iteration k, f2, x at iteration k, and f3 of x at iteration k. It would seem absurd that I start with a certain iteration and compute all the iterations by hand. This would be a punishment, right? So for that, I'm going to use MATLAB. MATLAB is way faster than me. It allows me to run, to check how the points behave as a function of iteration number. And so we get to see things faster. Okay, so now let's hop into MATLAB. And let me create a new script and call it root3d. And inside this root3d, I'm going to define my function f that takes in three numbers, x, y, z, and returns the function that we have. That is 16 times x1 to the power 4 plus 16 times x2 to the power 4 plus x3 to the power 4 minus 16. The second function is x1 squared plus x2 squared plus x3 squared minus 3. And the last function is x1 cubed minus x2. Okay, we have this function. Now let's create a main function. Let's call it main for Newton. Okay, let's define the number of iterations, let's say 10, that we're going to run Newton over. And let's define the values of x1, x2, x3 at the first iteration. So this guy is the initial guess. Then we're going to define a vector, call it x, to stack all these initial values. So x is going to be, let's say, a 3 by n iteration matrix at the end, because 3 is the number of variables that we have. And at each iteration, we're going to stack the current xn. So now let's define our function, even though we defined it here. Actually, this function, I defined it not because I'm going to use it in the main iteration of, in the main loop of Newton. No, I defined it so that I can have a solution using MATLAB subroutine, that is f solve. So with f solve, I can define my function at root3d, give it an initializer, and call x subroutine to solve this function with the current initialization. So if I copy paste all this guy right here in the command window, there you go. We have the values of f, but I need x subroutine. So this is the solution according to fsolve, which is the correct solution, because if I input it to my function as such, I get something really close to zero. Right, so now I'm going to run Newton's method, and actually, you know what? I don't need to define my function again. I'm good with this. This is my function. And if I pass it the following vector, I have my vector, but I need to transpose it. Okay, so I'm going to use this function. Okay, this is my f, right? This is my f. I'll do this. And in my Newton's method, I'll run from 2 till n iteration, right? Because I have my x1. So I need my x2, which is my x1 minus inverse d times my f of x n. Don't forget to transpose. Okay, actually, this is not transpose. This is transpose conjugate. But since we're dealing with real numbers, I won't have to worry about conjugate or not. Inverse, this is not an... Okay, this is the inverse of D, which is my matrix of partial derivatives, which is 64 times x1 cubed, 64 times x2 cubed, and 4 times x3 cubed. In the second row, I've got 2x1, 2x2, and 2x3. And in the last row, I've got 3x1 squared minus 1 and 0. And my x1 is taken to be, since I'm stacking, as we said up here, I'm going to stack at each iteration in x. Since I'm stacking, I'm going to read x1 as such. It's going to be from the previous iteration, and it's the first row. Likewise, x2 and x3 are going to be obtained from the second and third rows, right? So if I run all this, I get an error saying index and position 2, no. Okay, so what I usually do, I don't take a look at the error per se. I place a breakpoint and I run and I check. This one is 3 by 1, 3 by 1. If I invert this guy, it's 3 by 3, no problem. But the problem could come from here. So this guy is the problem. What is the problem? We can go ahead and do this. Again, error. What is the error saying? What if I do this? Okay. The problem is this. This guy should be n minus 1, right? If I do this, okay. And then this, okay. Which makes sense, because d is evaluated at xn minus 1 and f is also evaluated at xn minus 1. So let me go ahead and run this again. All is good. I have all my estimates right here. Look at the last row and look at the subroutine. Pretty close, if not the same. So we actually did a good job in conversion. Now, to visualize stuff, we're going to plot. And for plotting, I'm going to open a figure, plot x1 in red, set a line width of 1. I'm going to hold on and do the same thing for x2 and x3. As such, Now, likewise, I am going to plot the true value, which is x subroutine, but I'm going to have it over an iteration number of times because I want to plot a vector supported at x1. I'll plot it in dashed red, and I'll set a line width for this guy at 2. I'm going to do the same thing for x2 and x3, but just change their colors, okay? So that they're matchy-matchy. RR, MM, and black. Okay, let's label the x-axis as iteration number. And I'm going to set the interpreter just for rendering, just to have a nice render. And I'm going to place the y-axis as x, as such, x values. And grid on, grid minor. Let's run this. And there you have it. You can see x1, x2, and x3 converging to the true value after something like 4 iterations for this particular function, of course. Let's put dollar signs on the x so that it's rendered properly. And let's place a legend saying xn, x1, x2, x3, and fsolve x1, fsolve x2, and fsolve x3. And there you go. Okay, so you can go ahead and experiment with this really as much as you want. Let's say I change my initializer. See how initial conditions have a really important role in the convergence of your algorithm? It's really important. Let's change this to 0. Right here, we don't see anything. I don't know where the points went. Let's test this here. X, not a number. I'm sure because the derivative blew up to infinity. So the D matrix, yeah, at some point, here it's okay. Let's go to the second iteration. Haha, because if we go here, we check D, we check its eigenvalues. We have 2 0 eigenvalues, which means that your D matrix is not invertible. You can test on the rank. So rank D is 2. So if rank D is 3, you're good. Else, 3 because 3 variables. This should be extended to n if you're looking forward to generalize this function. So rank D is 3, you're good. Else, you have to throw we'll do a warning. D is uninvertible and break. That case, if we run this, we get a warning here and then we break. Take a look at x. Actually, we need to clear. Sorry about that. Need to clear over here, clear all and CLC. So this is X. It doesn't show you not a number. It doesn't do the effort of continuing. So as I said, your initial values are very, very important for the operation of Newton's method. Because at some point, if your Newton's method is evaluating D at a singular point, then you cannot invert this matrix. Okay, this is one downside of Newton. It requires gradient inverse. Okay, let's experiment with other points. Again, we got this problem. So this guy is important. I think this guy is the one that's causing all this. Yep. Look over here. It starts to wiggle around and it's not doing good. Let's take a look at 100 iterations. Boom. At some point, we stopped iterating at the 26th iteration. So this initializer is not good. Let's do something like this. Uh-huh. Look at how beautiful this is. This is so beautiful. Let's do something like this. This guy converges, but not quite. Not quite. Again, there are some conditions on the initial value. I'm not going to talk about in this lecture. So yes, it depends on some theorems of convergence. If you care about those type of theorems, let me know down in the comment section below and I'll dedicate a lesson on that. So that's it for this one. We talked about Newton's method for nonlinear systems or for matrix systems. We saw how to have an analog definition between one-dimensional Newton and n-dimensional Newton. Then we saw an example on how to get it implemented on a 3x3 system, which could easily be extended for n-by-n system. Okay, so thanks for watching. I'll be leaving a written version of this lecture on my website. The link is attached down in the description section below, and I'll be doing this more frequently. So thanks for watching. If you found this lecture beneficial, please leave a like on the video, subscribe to the channel. If you have any questions whatsoever, don't be shy. Leave a comment down in the comment section below. I'll make sure I'll get to it as soon as possible, and I'll be seeing you then.